we have the PIT CMO Summit getting into the very special panel discussion. And I can't wait to introduce a panelist followed by the moderator who will take charge and bring to you all those thoughts which might be in a form of question in your mind, but a moderator will bring all that to the table and make sure that answers are here without you thinking of any question. So let's get ready and call first our panelists. Well, our subject today of talking and discussing is going to be creating a purpose-driven and resilient brand. Now, there's so much around this entire topic, and let's get straight and welcome first our panelists. Please welcome Managing Director, NEPA India Private Limited, Isha Nagar. Joining her is going to be co-founder, Chief Product and Operating Officer of our very, very amazing partner as well, is Zozo Day, Manoj Agarwal. Joining the two is going to be Director, Consumer Products Division, L'Oreal India, Pankaj Sharma. Also joining three is Country Marketing Director, Dell Technologies India, Ritu Gupta, and Head of Marketing India, Under Armour, Siddharth Pal. All of them are joining us right now, and all this has been chaired by our moderator. Please welcome the very, very happy soul, always smiling, CEO, Starcom India, Rathi Gangappa, with a big round of applause, please.
Thanks so much, Mithun. Even though if I was not really happy smiling, I'm now happy smiling, so thank you for that. Good afternoon, everybody. Really, really excited to be here to host this and moderate this panel discussion. As mentioned earlier on in the session, today marks 1 year since India went into lockdown, and what a year it has been. For us who are in the business of brands, it has been a year where we had to relook at how, as marketers, we communicate with our consumers. Also, it is time to go back to the basics, to what a brand stands for, what is the brand's core, its purpose, mission, and vision. Consumers today are increasingly looking at investing in brands that reflect their values, and it is here that defining and staying true to the brand purpose can help a brand tide a crisis. That's because a company that leads with a purpose and is relevant to consumers' need can achieve loyalty, thereby translating into increased brand salience, sales, and growth. Joining me today to discuss this is an eclectic set of panelists who will share with us their insights on some of the excellent work that they have done in creating purpose-driven and resilient brands. So a warm welcome to all of you panelists here. Amitabh Pandey, Marketing Head, IKEA India; Isha Nagar, Managing Director, NEPA; Manoj Agrawal, Co-Founder, Chief Product and Operating Officer, Zozo Day; Pankaj Sharma, Director, Consumer Products Division, L'Oreal; Ritu Gupta, Country Marketing Director, Dell Technologies India; and of course, Siddharth Pal, Head of Marketing, Under Armour India. Extending a warm welcome once again to all of you, and thanking you for joining us here today. So without much further ado, I thought I'll set up this session and hand over the floor to Isha, who can give us a lot of insights based on the research that she has done through NEPA. The question to you, Isha, is how are consumers living and thinking and buying differently today? What are the unexpected routine shifts, newer challenges that brands are facing today? And how are these brands adapting to consumers who are now increasingly becoming socially conscious?
Thanks, Rathi, for setting the context. Just doing a quick audio check, I'm audible to you. So just going ahead and taking that question up, I think the whole context setting of this topic would have been so different if we were discussing this March 2020. So we really just cannot ignore how the last year has been and how everything has really changed from a consumer perspective. And while the 1.4 billion, the India that we see has been starting their adjustment journey, so to say, how they have been living, buying, and thinking very differently. So at our end, at NEPA, we have seen both the shift in the consumer narrative and thus also in the brand narrative. We've seen some maxims really changing for the consumer by the virtue of what has been important to them and how the deprioritization of something which was as basic in 2019 and earlier years has been completely taken up by things which we could have not really think about if we were to take out COVID from the context altogether. So some of the trends that we have been observing on the consumer side has been that there had been a massive, massive shift on content making people content, so to say. That was sort of becoming basic necessity in terms of the consumer's life in the last 1 year or so. We also saw, I personally had been very passionate about this piece, which was the rise of a super me, which was the rise of an individual who was balancing, who was reimagining offices, who was reimagining the homes, and upskilling on the way, right? We had been seeing a lot of people doing 5 to 6 tasks or activities in a day to keep them busy. So it was a rise of super me, which made things very interesting. And the last, but definitely not the least, was we saw a lot of breaking the norms in India, which is things which just completely were foreign in terms of both our culture, in terms of both, there was a lot of things that people were doing for the first time, cooking first time, exercising first time. And that's the whole construct of what formed the priority in terms of being critical changed, and we were breaking norms on the way. However, for the brands, because you said that it's about how socially conscious the consumers have become, and the panelists would agree, it has been very challenging for the brands because it has been a overly complicated and a very diverse communication landscape. And the challenges have been to understand the new purchase pattern, the new purchase cycle, and sort of to break in the new consumer sentiment in terms of how they are thinking, altogether. Because it's no more about just the brand funnel or just the top parameters on salience, but also about the conversions and the net impact on churning out creative communication versus what is really leading to the purchase. So already, as it wasn't complex, now we are dealing with completely different socio-cultural and economic landscape changing because of COVID. So that's that. Both the narratives changing, but I'll then open up for the brands because it just directly leads into the question of the funnel and the sales sentiment. So.
Yeah, thank you so much, Isha. I think that sets up a good context for getting the brand folks on board. So I think it's also a nice segue to, asking Amitabh the next question, since Isha spoke so much about the changes that are happening in the home front, right? So Amitabh, doing good business is so ingrained in everything that IKEA does, right? It is representative of the way you use your resources to help address economic, social, and environmental changes. So can you speak a little bit more about how you're anchoring this in, every part of everyday life for India with the launches that you've done in the last couple of years?
Sure, Adi, happy to do that. Are you able to hear me all right?
Yeah, we can.
Super good. I think apologies to the pitch team that I didn't do the background that everybody else has. I think one of it was, I think it just kind of slipped the radar is the honesty. But I think if I were to put the brand angle, as a brand, you're all about life at home. So I have to show my life at home if I'm being true to my brand. Jokes apart, I think to answer the question, Rati, I think for IKEA, I think I think we are quite blessed. I think I'm quite blessed to kind of be heading marketing for a brand like IKEA, which kind of has purpose at the heart of the brand right from the word go. So I know there's a conversation around brand purpose has kind of become really top of mind for a lot of brands in the last year post COVID. But for us, for the last 75 years around the world that we've existed, that's always been business as usual. It comes, I think the origins, as many of you know, we're a Swedish origin company, and kind of we bring those Swedish values to most of the countries, and purpose is one of those things. So how we kind of do it, in fact, the whole point of entering a country like India comes from realizing our vision or purpose, as we call it, the line that we have, that we use very actively, like almost on a daily conversation basis, is to create a better everyday life for the many people. Which country has the many, many people in this world, right? And India becomes the obvious answer. So actually entering India a couple of years ago is part of kind of satisfying this global mission that we have. If I were to take that forward, I mean, if you just kind of break down the many people, I think that's how we kind of, live our purpose on a day-to-day basis. One is, I think, going, if you look at the many people from a customer's point of view, they're really, our purpose is built into the very commercial idea. So purpose is commercial for us. So when we say better everyday life for the many people, it's about life at home, what their needs are, and giving high quality, great design products at really affordable prices, so that this great design and functionality is not for the few. It's for everybody. So that's kind of almost at the heart of our customer proposition. If you take it from a co-worker perspective and our employees, things like equality, we are 50-50 men and women equal across all functions, across all levels. That's by design. Even in functions like logistics, where it's which are male-dominated areas, we go out of our way to make sure that we are kind of, we have a 50-50 balance in gender. Representing the demographic of the city that we operated, ethnic-wise, income-wise, is kind of inclusivity and diversity and inclusion is a big part of it. So you talk about co-workers. You take it at the back end from a supplier's point of view. I think the same kind of logic applies there, where we partner with them on a long-term basis to kind of build sustainable, environmental-friendly and values that we share with our suppliers. And then finally, I think coming to sustainability, it's almost business as usual. It's right from the design of our products to the sourcing of how we source at the back end, again, through these partnerships, including the products and to the products, encouraging people to live sustainable lives at home. So water-saving taps, LED lights, curtains that cool down and protect heat in a natural way, making products out of the rice straws from Punjab that are getting, things like that. So that's almost built into what we do. So I think if you look at that, it's almost a way of being for us at IKEA, and I'm really blessed to be here, so that it's not something that is, it's like, is there any other way to do marketing which is not purpose marketing? It's almost, I think, we're at that space, and quite blessed to be in that position.
Yeah, so I like that term that you used, or the phrase that you use, right? Commerciality is anchored in our purpose, right? Yeah. Everything that we do is centered around that purpose. You just every corner of wherever IKEA touches, that's where, it's ingrained and it's rooted in that particular purpose. Thank you so much for that, Amitabh. We'll come back. But, we've been talking about COVID, post-COVID, pre-COVID and stuff for that. But, there are two brands over here, Dell and L'Oreal, which have been doing and embracing or, working on a brand purpose for a very, very long time. So the next question that I like to pose to is Ritu, if you can talk a little bit more about how at Dell, you've been changing people's attitudes and behaviors, and more importantly, even sales growth. I mean, let's even touch upon that, right? How you've been doing that at Dell with purpose or with, embracing brand purpose.
Hey, thanks, Rati. Audible?
Yes, you're audible.
Okay, perfect. Hey, thanks for, that's a great question. So Dell Technologies, as we know, it's a relatively younger brand. We're all of under 40. We're not yet hit 40. We're a 37-year-old brand born out of Michael Dell's university dorm room in the University of Texas. And it was really back then, the whole thing was founded on the belief and passion that everyone everywhere should have access, easy access to technology, and that is really what forms the basis and purpose of how we define our purpose. It's about creating technology that drives human progress, right? So even when we look at our culture code, our everything, it's about the way we do things. It's about who we are and not just about the way we do things. So the way the vision of the company is also defined is in terms of delivering a better tomorrow, because we believe that we are driven by the world we want to live in, right? So everything that we do right from the word go, whether it's about, and we also believe that technology actually has the ability to actually address a lot of other societal, complex societal and issues, whether it is education, whether it is healthcare, whether it is sustainability or even digital economy. So in the last 1 year, I think that importance and how technology can seep into the minutest areas and influence the minutest areas of our lives has become very, 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 very evident from that overall perspective. So when and I'm fortunate, I completely understand where Amitabh's coming from, because when you work for a brand where everything that you do and everything who you are and what defines you is so seeped into the purpose that the brand delivers and derives, and you live it as part of your DNA, it's a very different experience. And that's as a marketeer, as a brand custodian, that's the filter and that's the cap that you wear at every point of time when you're looking and evaluating your marketing actions as to how does this go back and tie back to my brand's purpose, to my brand's vision, you know, whether it is in the area of sustainability, whether it's in the area of inclusion, whether it's in the area of driving more skill-based employability, because we believe that when you look at a country like India, you know, which has demographics as its core dividend, you know, we are a very, very young nation, and education is a key driver for key driver for economic growth in any country. How can technology play a very strong role in that place? Because that forms the basis of the skilled workforce that you are creating for the future. In a world and an economy which is moving towards being more and more digitized. So you cannot just keep your eyes closed from that. And hence a whole lot of activities that we do, be it marketing or be it outside of marketing. And I'm not going to use the word CSR because they're probably not necessarily in the CSR space, right? Those are the activities because they do have a commercial, aspect. Now, it's not something as blatantly commercial as, you know, I'm giving my pieces away at a 50% discount, because you're not eroding into brand value. But what you're actually doing is you're demonstrating the value that the product, and particularly in the space of technology, that it can bring, whether it's about making sure that, you know, there's a mobile school which is running in Africa, or you make sure that they are, technology education which is imparted to even the to teachers in our schools. And I want to bring an example here of a program that we've been running almost, I would say, in different avatars for the last almost 10 years now. But I would love, let's say I talk about the last 4 years. So when we're really looking at, like I said, education is core to any country's progress, right? And we know that, you know, particularly in a country like India, where you have the demographic dividend and you have education, but how do you make sure that this population, which is going to be the future workforce for a country where you don't want it, you don't necessarily want it to be a country of consumers, you want it to be a country of creators, because that is what propels overall growth in the economy. How do you make sure that you're doing that? And we said, okay, so, you know, how do you really demonstrate the use and benefit of technology, particularly in the space of education? That's where that really, really started from, and it's evolved over the course of the last 4.5, 5 years. And when we looked back at that scenario, we realized that the core to this education process for a child in their developmental years is the teacher. But hey, guess what? Neither the teacher nor the mother is as comfortable with technology as we would want them to be, because they themselves have not experienced technology, have not worked on technology for them to be able to experience what technology can do, whether it's in lesson planning, whether it's in making sure that the entire learning becomes more intuitive and more interactive as against rote mechanism that probably we've all been brought up on. And that was the genesis. And also, you know, if I may, this was basically the inspiration behind this was a very young boy, a 10-year-old boy called Shubham, who lives in a village on the outside of Nasik in Maharashtra. And it was really when we were doing a program that he really inspired us, his story as to how that child, you know, despite his circumstances, he was a son of a farmer family, and despite his circumstances, that boy is so bright, absolutely so bright, that his parents invested into buying a PC for him. And the guy actually was able to, you know, he was explaining to us how a windmill works. When I was 10 years old, I probably did not even know what a windmill was, right? But here was this little kid in a school in somewhere in back of beyond Maharashtra, in a village outside of Nasik city, where he's talking about it, and his parents are so happy. They're not educated, but they're super proud of what he's doing, because he's like, we're kind of sure that he'll be able to make something of himself, right? So whether it's interaction with doctors or whatever, they're sitting there and this little boy converses with the doctors in English, and you have this pride that you can see in his parents' eyes, because he's very, you know, they're very happy that he's actually able to move in step with the times. So that little experience for us created this program called Aarambh, which is Hindi for, as we all know, is Hindi for the beginning. And Aarambh was a program whereby which we started training teachers in schools about the use of technology in lesson planning and in education, and how classes and learning can be made more fun. So, and I think over the course of the last 4.5 years, we've actually trained over 100,000 teachers, over 130,000 mothers across 80 towns, and we've touched about 4,000 schools. All in all, to make sure that, you know, as they grow, now these are people who may not buy a PC tomorrow, or they may not buy a Dell tomorrow, you know, equally importantly for me, but it's about bringing that mindset shift that yes, it is about, you know, you cannot be ignoring technology as you go along. And last year, when, you know, like you said, today is probably the anniversary for the first lockdown that we had in the country. And when that lockdown happened, this entire 4.5-5-year-old program came to a standstill because it was a school contact program. We pivoted the whole thing to become online and digital. But the kind of response that we got from parents and from teachers from far and wide across the country, because this was a need gap. This was a gap that they were all looking forward to. How do I make my classes interesting? How do I even plan for imparting education online? As a parent, how do I prepare my child to study online? What kind of shifts or changes I need to do in my home, in my attitude? What do I do? How do I provide the right set of, you know, security features and everything? So that's just one example that I'm saying. You know, and there are lots more that I can talk about. But yes, to be able to make sure, because we believe when we're combining technology with human spirit, and that is where the whole combination comes through, is probably one of the most positive forces in the world. And that's what we would want to go and nurture.
Thank you, Ritu. So would you say that, you know, COVID to a certain extent helped, you know, change things around, gave you the impetus in terms of sales growth? Was there a difference from what it was before to now? Or is it the same momentum that you see that keeps going?
I think COVID definitely, to answer your question, has COVID definitely given this whole category an impetus, for sure. Cannot take that fact away. That said, even before COVID, when we did an impact assessment study amongst those 4,000 schools and the teachers that we had trained, we could measure a pre and post attitudinal shift. And the fact that they had begun to use technology, even if it was piecemeal, the fact that whenever they brought technology into the classroom, the students were far more attentive. They were far more focused. The classes were a lot more interactive as against struggling to keep a child's attention in place. So the teachers and the principals, they could start using the technology and we could sense that shift. I think the behavioral shift got pushed by COVID because of all the learn from home and the work from home things that came into place. But I think when we started this journey almost 4.5-5 years back, it was really about demonstrating and building in that technology into our education system to make sure that we're preparing a workforce which is ready for the digital economy of the future.
Thank you. Pankaj, you know, with the launch of Green Beauty, right? I mean, I've seen your brands, I've grown with using your brands, both L'Oreal and Garnier, but I've seen a sea change from what it was earlier to what it is now in terms of what you're talking, you know, out there to the consumers or the work that you're doing in the brand purpose space. And more recently with the launch of Green Beauty, Garnier has taken on the challenge of becoming the most sustainable, natural and accessible beauty brand, right, in the mass market. And of course, L'Oreal, you know, earlier on in the last couple of years, I've seen a couple of, you know, communication pieces on where it's standing up to sexual harassment in, you know, on streets. So when we talk about purpose, I mean, which is closer to the brand, how do you select what is the right fit, right? Also, how do you make that choice? And more importantly, how do you believe that these initiatives that you take help build the brand equity, whether it's Garnier Beauty, Green Beauty, or even the L'Oreal stance on sexual harassment or whatever else that you are doing right now in the space?
Yeah. So thank you. Thank you. And very happy to be here. You know, before I talk about the Green Beauty Initiative and the L'Oreal Paris Initiative, just to again go back to the point you were making, that today we feel at L'Oreal that the strength of the brand will be very much based on the purpose than it was in the past. It's not that purpose was not important before, but I think the kind of crisis, you know, we all have gone through in the last 1 year has accentuated the need to have a very sharp purpose. And today, you know, the world we live in, right? I think consumers are demanding much more, you know, from their brands. Before, you could have sold a brand on its performance, on its power, on its saliency. But I think in today's world, that is no longer enough. Okay, consumer, like the everybody loves progress, right? We want our governments to change our society. We have a lot of expectations from the government. I think similarly, consumers are having expectations from the organization. Okay, what is the progress? You know, it's not only the selling the product, but what is the larger impact an organization is having on this planet? And today, like we vote for the governments, I think consumers vote for the brands or vote for the organization by buying their products. So there is this trend, and I think one is COVID, which has made this trend more prominent today. But the second thing I think is the most digital, because today it was a very top-down dialogue, but today it's a two-way street. It's a dialogue. Before it was a comment, it was a slogan from the advertising from the top down. So once it's a two-way street, I think consumers can have a very meaningful dialogue with the brands, and that is also pushing the boundary. And I don't think any brand can hide, right? Every brand is in open. What do they do? What are the ramifications of their action? Everything is out there in the open. So that has changed for me. That is the biggest shift which has happened. COVID has accelerated that, but I think the shift was happening before that because of digital and the social communication we all are engaged in. Now once you see these trends, obviously L'Oréal has been committed as an organization, and it's not about turning around a purpose in 1 year or 2 years, as I think other people spoke about it. It has to be ingrained. It has to be the part of the DNA. And 50 years back, when we said on a brand called L'Oréal Paris that you are worth it, everyone is worth it, we already insinuated that, the values of inclusivity, the values of respect, and values of harmony. What we have done recently, and again to the question that, how do we take on the purpose? And we know it very well for the brands. There's obviously also a big task on building brands to the right cohort of the consumers. So you take a purpose which fits with the, which works well with the brand equity, the core brand equity which brand wants to develop. An example, what you spoke about, Garnier. So Garnier is a big natural beauty brand, a mass beauty brand in the world. And the task which they have taken is the green beauty, which in the next 2-3 years, there's strong commitment made on the usage of plastic, on the sourcing of the raw materials. And these commitments are made very open, right? And they're very bold commitments. And obviously the work for these commitments started a long time back. And an example, we have been recently recognized as a cruelty-free, by an international Leaping Bunny program by the cruelty-free international organization. So that's another piece on Garnier, which we have rolled out. So it's a big purpose on Garnier Green Beauty, which has been rolled out in India. And it fits with the brand equity. And that means it assures even a marketeer or even the brand manager that, okay, as long as they build the Garnier Green Beauty, they're also building the brand. If both things are disconnected, I think then the journey is not very long. And similarly, on L'Oréal Paris, we have taken a very strong cause on street harassment and educating people, a bystander, how could they prevent street harassment? What action could be taken? And again, it ties up with the goal of the brand, which is again, women empowerment. So again, in the women empowerment, this is the initiative which have been rolled out. And I think important pieces on the purpose when these things are announced is how transparent it is. So we have taken extreme step. Okay, while we announce this purpose for the Garnier Green Beauty, we have, transparency is important. So we have something called a progress report, which will be available on the Garnier.com every month. Anybody can log into Garnier.com and see the progress report, all the commitments, where we stand today. Similarly, our goal on the street harassment part is not to create awareness. The idea is to change, right? And the change would happen if the focus is much more on the training part. What we are calling a 5D training, which anyone of us can take, which clarifies or recommends the kind of steps which we can take to prevent sexual harassment. And hence, I would say, yes, purpose is important. It's more important than yesterday in today's time. But it's also important to tie the purpose with the DNA of the brand and with the positioning of the brand, and at the same time, make that purpose more meaningful and make it more transparent so more and more consumers can involve and participate in it.
And would you also say that embracing a particular purpose, or which, you know, is core to the DNA of the brand, helps you in, you know, the every single consumer part of the single consumer journey. It's not just about awareness, it's about the full funnel, that it plays a role in every funnel, part of the funnel, when it comes to the consumer journey.
No, it definitely, it does help. Obviously, the big goal is not to make it a complete marketing mandate. I think it goes beyond the marketing mandate. It reflects on the organizational values. It reflects on the brand values, the brand, what it wants to be famous for. And the intervention of this purpose could be installed in every consumer journey. And an example on Garnier Green Beauty, you know, today we are working on a label which will declare we'll launch it by the end of 2022, the impact label. So like you on the product, you see the price, you see the manufacturing date, you see when it is going to get expired. You'll also see social impact label, which will range from score A to E, A being for the best on the sustainability score. So it will be that transparent to the consumer, helping consumers to make more sustainable choices. So, you know, which is the last mile of the consumer journey when they're buying the product. So, and that's what we have worked backwards, covering all consumer touch points. And also, I think Amitabh spoke about it with the vendors, with the back end. Because once you do once you say something or purpose or a mission, then it goes across the organization end to end.
Thank you, Pankaj. Siddharth, this is over to you. Under Armour is one of the most exciting brands that I'm privileged and my team is privileged to be working on. It's really excited that you launched finally in India. Fairly young brand compared to all the others on this panel. So can you just spend some time, talking about your journey so far? And what are your plans to bring your brand purpose to life?
Cool. Are you able to hear me?
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, in fact, we are a 24-year-old brand versus other sports brands who are more than 50 years old. We are the brand of the 90s. We are fairly young. And in India, we launched in 2019. So we are younger than most of the brands here. And, 2019, on the 25th of March, we opened our first store. Everybody here, I mean, Pankaj, Ritu, Amitabh talked about brand purpose and sustainability. I mean, what COVID has made us realize that you need a bigger purpose, even if, you're a brand or, professionally as well as personally as well, So there is purpose defined to everything that we do now, and more so, after COVID. Sports is something that, it's inbuilt in sports to help you be better. Team sports make you learn a lot, many things. Sports as a category, when you play sports, you learn a lot of things. And for a brand, it's more exciting to be in that space, right? All the other brands who are in the competition, be it our competition, Nike, Adidas, or even Under Armour, right? And Under Armour's core purpose as a, mission is to make you better. Because you can actually wear, our products on the field when you're training or when you're playing sports. So I think that fulfills, our purpose in terms of, delivering better products and helping athletes, become better, whatever they do. And, what we've realized that, in 2019, when we launched, we thought that, we launch it with one of our core ambassadors and, who've been with us for nearly, more than 10 years now. And, he's the all time Olympian in terms of, what he's achieved, Michael Phelps. And, I'll just share an example of, when he was in India and what he saw. And, he was chatting with me. And, the first thing is he asked me that, there is this level of passion that India has. And he interacted with kids. He interacted with, trainers. He interacted with cricket players. He had the opportunity to interact with a lot of people, from ages from 6, 7 to, 40s and across categories, sports categories. And he was asking, you guys are young, right? We are 50% of the population is below 30. And you know, what is that one thing, you know, that is missing when it comes to, you know, being in the Olympics? And I mean, there are a lot of things. And, you know, he spoke so passionately about sports. He had the chance to play cricket with one of the IPL teams. And, you know, what I garnered from him is that there is this part of discipline that comes when you are a professional athlete and when you are working with a brand. And that discipline is you know, making a routine of yourself, doing what you're passionate about, you know, serving a life's purpose. All of us in Under Armour have a purpose to help our athletes perform better. And with his, you know, his passion, he was speaking about it. He, for 18 years of his life, he hadn't had a sip of alcohol or nor a Coke, nor a Pepsi, nothing of that sort. For 18 years, after he retired in 32, that's the first sip he took. Of an alcohol, and he said, you know, it that's what athletes go through, and he was just passionately speaking about how Under Armour was with him, you know, throughout his journey. I mean, he suffered some losses in the way. He talked about mental, you know, depression during his time in the Olympics, and he spoke freely about it, you know, onto the media. So I think that's what, you know, we speak about when we've been with that athlete, you know, who's reached at his pinnacle and, you know, served him with the best of products. I mean, that's something that, you know, we at Under Armour, and I'm particularly proud of, considering that we've been in India for 3 years. Right now, I think that what has happened in COVID, people have realized that one of the key things to survive this century is to make sure you're healthy, right? I mean, our general perception about health, workout, being responsible what you eat, being responsible what you do, has you know, taken a major step forward in terms of other you know, wants that people have, and you know, we've seen that come through our you know, ambassadors that we have in India, you know, who are not at a level of, you know, what a cricketer is, but you know, we managed to get deep dive into understanding authentic people who bring out authentic change, and not, you know, maybe that's a strategy that we built into, but you know, some of the examples that we have a trainer who's in the name of Zoe Modgill. I mean, she doesn't have a massive following on Instagram, but you know, she tells me that she does this class every week where 100 women take part in it. And she has changed lives of women who've been going through a lot of, you know, post-pregnancy, you know, fat and stuff like that. And she has this module that runs through, and it's that passion that, you know, really drives her to do that stuff. And her passion really drives us to help her in whatever way we can. And, you know, I think that's where our purpose comes through. I mean, we don't want to go out in the open and announce that, you know, we rather serve the purpose with an athlete, and through that athlete, you know, help others who are motivated to, you know, get into a healthy routine. So, and you know, you will see a lot of people coming in the brand space, joining us in this movement of, you know, training, and be it running, be it contact sports, be it Olympics. And soon I think, and India is moving in that kind of direction, right? I mean, there is a lot of push across brands, across industries, to help India become a superpower in terms of, you know, being one of the biggest contenders in the Olympics. I think that's where the goal is, and that's where the game is. So our idea is to just help each and every athlete, and an athlete can be anybody, right? Who, it can be you, Rati, it can be Ritu, it can be Pankaj, who goes to the gym 4 or 3 days a week, who are passionate about their health. You know, they eat right, they want to make sure that the kids work out and go outdoors, and you know, and that's what our audience is. You know, it's the focused performer, that's how we say it, you know, who's focused in its own discipline of sports or training that he or she does, and we are just ready to support them. So I think that's our purpose, and I think that's my purpose, you know, of and I've been in the industry for more than a decade now. So I think that's my purpose, to bring out the best of sports in each city that, you know, India has, and bring out the athlete in every person that I meet. So yeah, that's the purpose.
But also a conscious effort to stay away from mainstream sports. And, you know, I know you have an association with the Indian women hockey team. That's wonderful. But is there a conscious effort to actually stay away from mainstream sports like cricket?
Because of what we've done, I think we've made sure that we stay away from cricket. I mean, the signings that we've done and the things that we're doing, I think there are other brands who are taking that responsibility of making sure that they sponsor the big cricketers and help cricket grow in India. I think it's our responsibility to make sure that we serve the underdogs. And that's one of the big examples is the women ice hockey team. We signed them. We did a campaign with them. We supported them in whatever journey they've been through. And, you know, there aren't many ice skating rinks in India. There are hardly any, actually. So, you know, the team has to go to countries like Kuwait or other countries to, you know, practice. It's difficult to practice here in India because of the conditions. So I guess we have our own purpose to serve the underdogs, and there are other brands who are, you know, serving the purpose of helping cricket grow. So yeah, I'm fine with that.
Yeah, I know. That's a good thing. Even we are fine with that, Sid. moving on. Thanks so much, Sid. Manoj, I kind of purposely left you for the last. You know, I hope you don't mind on that, but I thought you'll have a different perspective as a startup, as an entrepreneur. How has your journey been so far? I mean, is it any different in terms of, you know, building a purpose as to what the others spoke about over here? Is it more or less the same? Can you talk a little bit about what you went through and what your purpose is with Zozodi?
Yeah, thanks, Rati. I hope I'm audible.
You are, Manoj, you are.
Yeah, so I guess I'm the youngest brand here. I mean, we are the youngest company in this panel. And today I'm wearing a dual hat here. So being an entrepreneur and also being part of a marketing panel. So I'll try to balance my answers, keeping in mind both those hats. Many times you are not purpose first companies. I mean, purpose is kind of acquired over a period of time, because when you talk about early stage companies, and I'm sure that each of the panel members, if they ask their founders that, okay, how was Dell when Michael Dell started it, and how was L'Oreal in the early days of L'Oreal? It's like, how can I save the world when I'm barely saving myself? So that is how entrepreneurs go through that journey, that, okay, it's like the popular saying in your flight that, okay, help others only after you help yourself while putting that mask and so on. So that is all about early stage startups and then founders and all these companies go through that kind of a mindset. So first establish yourself and then try to kind of help others. Otherwise, whatever purpose you build for others, it won't be sustainable. I mean, you might be doing bits and pieces of this and that, but can it be long-term? Maybe no. So yes, I mean, in the initial 4 to 5 years, we were just navigating through our own journey that, okay, what are we doing as a company? What is our product market fit? What is the customer liking us for, and so on. And over the last 2-3 years, yes, we have established that what we are doing. And then now we have that bandwidth and we have that clarity that, okay, yes, now this is the purpose of the brand and this is what we can do. And this is how we can make some impact in the lives of others. Now, so just like millions of other businesses in the world, we are not purpose first company. I mean, I would say an Akshay Patra is a purpose first company because Akshay Patra is started with that motive, or I would say some kind of an NGO who might be doing it right from day one as a purpose first company. We are all purpose acquired companies. We try to kind of give it back to the society when we have enough of it. So I think that is how most of the brands are doing their purpose driven kind of marketing. Now, in terms of our business, we are in the business of human motivation, and through our technology products, we help companies to motivate and add some kind of smile in the lives of whether it's their employees or their channel partners or their sales guys or maybe their consumers, that how can you really drive some performance, some productivity by adding some ingredients of motivation? And motivation is a simple, but I mean, simplest things are hardest to build. Now the COVID period especially also highlighted that there is a huge scarcity of motivation in human beings. I mean, COVID actually exposed the entire need of human motivation, and it exposed the need of human gratitude. That, I mean, a simple thank you or a simple gratitude can change your life and can change your day. And we all went through that. So as a business, that is what we do, and that is how we help our clients to kind of achieve that kind of a purpose. That I mean, it doesn't take a lot to say thank you to your delivery boy, say thank you to maybe your employee, say thank you to your customer care guy who has just forgotten his Holi and Diwali and is just working day in, day out, and facing the wrath of the customers on the one side and facing the wrath of the employees on the other side. So how do you balance that? So, I mean, we have found the purpose on our way by taking this motto of gratitude, thankfulness, and the entire science of appreciation. That yes, I mean, appreciation really matters in everybody's life, whether it is personal or professional. So how can you really add appreciation in the lives of whomever you are working with, and then make their days better and add a zozo into the day. So it's like, just like you have a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, you can also add a zozo day. More hugs and kisses, more appreciation, more gratitude. So yeah, I mean, this is how we have figured out our purpose. I mean, we never planned to do the purpose right from day one. I'll be very frank. We acquired purpose on our journey. Yeah.
So Manoj, I mean, if I were to bring in what one of the comments that Byron Sharp had done, you know, he says that it's purpose is what I call a distraction. Is that what you're talking about? I mean, do you think it's just the talk that the companies are doing, or companies are actually walking the talk today?
Yeah, so a lot of companies have actually walked the talk. I mean, if I talk about, say, purpose first or purpose acquired, there are a lot of names. And even if we talk about, say, a person, an individual is also a brand. So, I mean, I might sound theoretical, but let's say if we talk about people like, say, Mother Teresa or maybe Oprah Winfrey and so on. I mean, these are brands by themselves, and they have walked the talk. I mean, they have not just talked the talk. And I will recall that book from Simon where, I mean, most of us are generally busy in the what and how. I mean, and then why is tough. I mean, answering the why and then really committed to that why takes time, and then it requires a lot of perseverance, it requires a lot of sacrifice. So I mean, not many brands have been purpose first brands, but yes, I mean, there have been a lot of success across the world. Whether purpose and profit can coexist, yes, very much. Purpose and profit can coexist. I mean, we have a panel here where, and then they have shown both of them together. And I can name some Indian brands who have done fantastically. I mean, most of the brands here we are talking about are international, but let's talk about brands like, say, Humdard, or maybe brands like Vico, or maybe Borolane, or maybe brands like Akshay Patra or Jindal Naturopathy. All these brands, and then even the brands like, say, if you know Super 30, the IIT coaching guy in Bihar, or maybe a Lijit Papad. So all these brands started with a purpose first, and then they have been doing it for like, say, decades and decades. And at the same time, there are a lot of brands who acquired it with time, and they have been doing fantastic as well. So as long as it is adding value to different stakeholders, I think it is perfectly fine. And people are actually doing it very well. Yeah.
Thanks, Manoj. I mean, actually, that leads me to the next question. I mean, allow this to either, you know, Pankaj or, you know, even Ritu to take this on. Just taking off from where Manoj was speaking, right? What are the challenges today of articulating a brand purpose? I mean, how do you actually ensure that you maintain consistency? You know, or from an IKEA perspective as well, how do you ensure that every piece of a connect that you come across, whether it's the consumer, your stakeholders, what goes into it? I mean, when I was working towards this, you know, setting up this panel discussion, one of the questions that a lot of people came and asked me is that, what are the challenges? Can you help articulate it for me? Pankaj, do you want to take this on?
Yeah. So as I said before, when you make a commitment, or when you declare your purpose, it's not an easy journey. You know, it's require a lot of clarity, the way the organization thinks, the way the you know, the values of the organization are embedded in across all functions. You know, and when we took this journey of green beauty, you know, it's so easy to say that we reduce plastic. You know, but now when you have to do walk the talk, you know, the kind of work it needs. You know, from we have to make sure that the raw material which we are sourcing, they are renewable. But at the same time, people who are giving us, our vendors who are giving us these raw materials, they are also following the sustainable roadmap. And then how we produce them in our factories, our factories are carbon neutral. How quickly they can become carbon neutral. Obviously, in India, we are becoming carbon neutral by the end of the year. And our supply chain, In that process, is there again a leakage, or is again a, you know, how can we make it even more sustainable? Our packaging which we use, how it should not use virgin plastic, and how can we have a recyclable plastic in every packaging? Once it gets consumed by the consumer and it comes back to the environment, whether it is again safe for the environment. So you have to look at the whole value chain and work and commit yourself that you walk the purpose which you have declared. So, and that's what it entails. And then everything you do, if sustainability is our purpose, if the purpose of L'Oreal is beauty for all, then how it should transmit across all the brands, all functions, all organization, and it should not become one part, one good part for the consumers, but actually it becomes your DNA. So, you know, when you take a bigger purpose and ingrain it and install it in your organizational values, then it's a very different, you know, take. And, you know, yes, purpose, first brand, required purpose. I think in any ways, it's a good to have a purpose because it works as a lighthouse. It also, you know, makes sure that, you know, the things which you are doing is aligned with the overall purpose you want to do. So it creates a good check mechanism across the organization for the people, and it creates value. You know, it does create value, and hence it, I would believe it does, there is no compromise on the profit because when you're talking about purpose. Yeah.
Yeah. Amitabh, I mean, it looks like for IKEA it's so easy, right? I mean, do you think there are any challenges from your front when it comes to, you know, embracing brand purpose?
No, I think it's maybe I sound make it sound easier than it is, but I think we come from is to keep it simple. You know, I think the minute we start putting jargons like purpose or even, you know, sustainability, all of, I think that's where we kind of complicate our lives, and then it becomes like this thing that we have to do separate from everyday business. You know, it's like if you take sustainability, right? For I mean, it's a concept that comes in a post-consumption world. But if you look at Indian culture, we've been recycling and reusing forever, right? I mean, we've been living sustainably forever. So if you go break it down into the basics, then I think it gets easier. And I think that's kind of our endeavor, to kind of not get caught up in these words of okay, purpose driven marketing and blah, blah. Because then it kind of it's a fake concept that we are trying to chase. I mean, similarly, if you look at purpose, you know, fundamentally it's as simple, we all seek purpose, right? It's something it's very natural. As a human being, we are driven by purpose. I mean, at the end of the day, that's why we're living. The purpose could be raising our children or our families, it could be whatever it is, but our entire life, purpose is very natural. It's a very normal human emotion that has come to us over years of evolution. So in that sense, it doesn't, it can be as simple as that. It's just kind of being able to kind of remind us that, hey, that's all it is, you know. Fundamentally, people want to do good. You know, it's a new school of thought of saying people are not bad. People fundamentally want to do good, right? Humankind, the book from Humankind, and all those kind of thinking. Fundamentally, all purpose is just being making sure that we're kind of going back to that basic human fundament rather than kind of overcomplicated and say, okay, let's write a book about purpose.
I know. A little bit on technology. I mean, I don't think we can, you know, not bring in technology at this day and age, right? So, Ritu at Dell, you're transforming businesses and driving human progress by harnessing technology, right? Similarly, Siddharth, you know, when I spoke to you, you spoke about how you're using technology in this whole brand purpose piece. So can either both of you touch upon a little bit about this in the last few minutes that we have before the panel closes? Ritu, over to you.
Sure. So, you know, I'm going to pick up the thread from where Amitabh left, because yes, it's important that we don't overcomplicate things, right? And also to the fact of what Manoj said, it really has to be, and what Pankaj said, it really has to be tops down. So if it is something which is seeped into your DNA, then it's easy to execute it and really live it by the day as part of what you do day to day, right from to every single employee in the organization and to every single thing that you do. Right. So whether it is sustainability, whether it is D&I, whether it is for us, whether it is education, whether it is skill development and employability, every single aspect of this, there are different manifestations of it, either as part of day to day or even as part of separate effort that you would want to do. So just to give an example, right? If I'm talking about sustainability, there is a India-based startup called Chakra. So what these guys do is they actually convert diesel soot. They have that ink, that black soot that gets collected at the with the diesel operation. So they actually collect a lot of that and they convert that into print ink powder. And Dell has actually worked very, very closely with them, and we use that ink to create that ink, which then is used on the pack boxes that we package our computers in before we ship them out. Now, what this required is the complete process, you know, at the back end had to be changed to make sure that there is a, you know, the earlier ink is being, you know, kept aside, and this new process needs to be woven into the entire manufacturing process to make sure that you are using and leveraging that as much to that possible. And then you're also saying, okay, if I'm doing this, what's the kind of impact that I'm able to create? So a rough calculation that we arrived at, that if you look at the amount of PCs that we ship out of our India, you know, out of India with that ink printed on it, we're probably taking care of the air that about 110,000 people breathe in and out on an annual basis. But is that enough? No, it's not. So the idea is to see how can we increase it more. The second example is in terms of inclusion, right? Amitabh said about 50% diversity ratio. So I think as a technology company, we're definitely not at a 50% right now, but at an overall employee base, we are probably at a 35. But as part of our 2030 moonshot goals that we've unveiled, you know, some months back, we are focused on making sure that our overall employee ratio is at a 50%, you know, male gender diversity. But at the leadership level, and which is where we see a bigger challenge, because we know that a lot of women opt out, you know, as they progress in life for various personal professional balancing reasons, we've actually given ourselves a goal of having a diversity ratio of 40% at that level. So to make sure that you are encouraging women to be, you know, in that space and providing the right ecosystem and the right environment for them to build on and work in that space. So there will always be challenges, and some things may seem, like we said, you know, these are moonshot goals. We need to make sure that we are working towards employability. We've taken ourselves upon ourselves a goal on 1:1. For every PC that we will sell, we will recycle another one. So it's literally a 1:1 ratio that we want to maintain to make sure that we are giving back as much as we are taking in from the, you know, from the environment. So things will have to be, as long as they are really, you know, top-down driven and they form the ethos of everything that we do as part of the culture code, as we define as to how do we do things, not just who we are, but how do we do things, and a combination of this, I think it will be able to, it's going to be not as difficult as it sounds.
Okay. What about you, Sid? I mean, innovation and performance enhancing technology, right, has been the genesis at Under Armour. So how are you leveraging new technology across your products and, your new offerings?
So the thing is, people, I mean, generally, we are expected to work till our mid-60s. But for life of an athlete, you know, usually used to end early 30s, in the 90s and the 80s. And very few people used to stretch it to, late 30s. But what we've seen in the last decade, if you've seen the kinds of, Tom Brady, who's our ambassador, he's he won a NFL championship again, and he's been winning since a decade now, and he's 43. He's a quarterback. He's playing one of the toughest sports in the world. There are other athletes like him, LeBron James, who's a basketball player. He's 36 now. Dhoni, who's still playing the IPL. I mean, there is this big shift of athletes who are now pushing their limit. And part of this reason is obviously what you eat, but recovery is a major component to all of this. I mean, generally we don't account for recovery as much as we do training. We are more happy and excited to get those 20 burpees and 30 burpees in, or play football for an hour or run 5 kilometers. But recovery is more important than actually in my and in our age group. When you are over 30. So people don't tend to get that, right? I mean, that's why you've seen a lot of injuries that happen at a pro or amateur level as well. One of the recent technologies that we've developed is called Under Armour Recovery Products, which is in partnership with, Tom Brady. I mean, he's helped us. What it does is, you can wear it after training. We have sleepwear as well. So it helps your body recover faster than normally what it takes, and there's a sleepwear collection. You can sleep with it. You can wear it after training, and it helps the blood flow, and, you can recover faster. Things like this, you need when you are playing sports in a day in, day out. The other thing is, from a technological standpoint, wearable technology is one of the biggest things now. Smartwatches have become big. Apps have become really big in during this pandemic as well. And what we did, before brands really thought about it, we already have a Bluetooth chip in all our running shoes. Most of our running shoes, which is Hover shoes, which is a technology, and they just sync it with the app, so you don't really need to wear a smartwatch. You just need to sync it with the shoe, and they identify the shoe color, what kind of shoe you're wearing. So I mean, there are spaces of performance of technology that exists within the sports ecosystem. Is how brands are leveraging it in a way that helps us as who are focused performers or who are amateur athletes, as well as the level of the Tom Brady's of the world. So I guess there is a lot of progression that we're going to see through in the next decade of technology, but this is something that we've already worked on in the past 3-4 years.
Thanks, Sid. Mithun, I don't know, do we have any audience questions, or could I end the session, the panel discussion, with one some sound bites from Isha? Do we have some time, or do you have any audience questions that you would want to ask the panelists?
So I have all of it. I have so many questions and more, and I would love to hear Isha talk as well. But unfortunately, we have time constraint, and our next speaker is already joined in at the back of the entire summit. So I think you should take charge and call it an end to this entire session.
All right. Thank you so much, everybody. Really enjoyed speaking to all of you. And if there are any questions, please, Mithun, send it across to the individual panelists, and we can see if we can answer them. And over to you, Mithun.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Siddharth. Thank you, Ritu. Thank you, Pankaj.
Thank you.
Thank you, Isha. Sure. And of course, Mr. Pandey, thank you so much again. My apologies, I completely missed out that you were joining as well. But yes, thank you again, Mr. Amitabh Pandey, for joining us. And of course, not to forget our moderator, Rathi. Thank you so much for joining us again. And I wish you great luck. I personally have so many questions, because it's my subject that I really talk and read about, but unfortunately, sometime soon, not now.
Okay. All yes. Right. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thanks. Thank you. Thanks, everyone. Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye.